Perched atop a building, Zhou utilized his stealth abilities to carefully observe the clandestine group that had attacked him. He soon discerned that they consisted of 5 individuals, all martial artists of rank 8. Their leader, surpassing them all, had reached the pinnacle of rank 8 martial arts. Over the next few days, Zhou continued his vigilant observation as the group engaged in their training regimen. 3 days later, during a moment of respite for the group, Zhou skillfully employed his stealth to closely monitor their activities. Ah Bing, the sniper who had targeted Zhou, harbored feelings of envy toward his friend, who had surpassed him in strength. Sensing a presence nearby, Ah Bing's friend wondered if his own sensitivity had heightened or if Zhou Zheng, now akin to a ghost, had come to hunt him. Another member of the group pointed out that even if Zhou had come to exact revenge, he would first seek out Ah Bing, as he had fired the initial shot. Listening attentively to their conversation, Zhou decided to bide his time until they were alone, ensuring an easier demise for them all. The following morning, Ah Bing's comrades left him stationed on the rooftop as a lookout while they continued their training. Seizing the opportunity, Zhou stealthily advanced toward Ah Bing from behind. Sensing an imminent presence, Ah Bing maintained vigilance with his sniper rifle, keeping watch over his companions. Swiftly seizing the moment, Zhou wasted no time and struck Ah Bing directly in the back with a deadly embedded poison. Stepping back, Zhou observed as the poison took effect, rendering Ah Bing motionless and incapacitated. Closing in for the final blow, Zhou put an end to Ah Bing's life. Meanwhile, Lao Zhang and Lao Gao engaged in combat with a horde of zombies, utilizing the encounter as a means to enhance their martial skills. Lao Gao proposed that they venture deeper into the area, deliberately seeking out more formidable challenges in the form of these zombies. Agreeing to the suggestion, Lao Zhang commenced his advance, unaware that Zhou lurked in the shadows, eavesdropping on their conversation. Reacting swiftly, Zhou shot 6 elite zombies, diverting their attention towards Lao Zhang and Lao Gao. Without hesitation, the two martial artists valiantly accepted the challenge, each taking on 3 elite zombies. Observing their valiant struggle, Zhou couldn't help but comment on their bravery, acknowledging the daring nature of a rank 8 martial artist who would willingly engage in combat with 3 elite zombies. Descending from the rooftop, Zhou patiently awaited the opportune moment to strike and eliminate his targets. Identifying a vulnerable opening, Zhou launched a surprise attack on Lao Zhang from behind, employing his embedded poison technique. However, before Zhou could deliver the finishing blow, Lao Zhang urgently informed Lao Gao of their assault. Alas, it was too late for Lao Gao, as Zhou swiftly immobilized him with a well-aimed dagger, effectively paralyzing him. With an instantaneous teleportation, Zhou materialized behind Lao Gao and swiftly severed his neck, reminding them that if they sought to eliminate him, they must pay the price. Training in the vicinity of Lao Gao and Lao Zhang's location. The boss, lost in his thoughts, gazed ahead, contemplating when he would acquire the qualifications to challenge that place. Despite Titan City's top expert, Chu He, being unable to accomplish it, the boss acknowledged that he still had a long way to go. One of the group members asked the boss about his pensive state, to which he replied that he was pondering the limits of their martial artists. Suddenly, they heard Lao Gao's voice, and as they reached his place, Zhou disappeared. In the moments before Lao Gao's demise, he informed them that Zhou Zheng was still alive. When the boss lifted his gaze towards a towering building, he witnessed Zhou's menacing threat to eliminate them all. Prompted by this, the boss and the remaining member embarked on an investigation, only to discover that Ah Bing had died before Lao Zhang and Lao Gao. The boss commented on how evident it was that they had become the prey, and as long as they remained alive, Zhou Zheng would not relent. Later, the boss and his comrade relocated their hiding spot to elude Zhou's pursuit. The boss commenced meditating, stating that not even Titan City's number one, Chu He, would dare claim that he could kill him. Unbeknownst to them, Zhou had already uncovered their new hideout. Subsequently, a colossal dragon departed from its lair in search of sustenance. Seizing the opportunity, Zhou ventured towards the dragon's nest as it pertained to the hell mission he recently accepted. The dragon would return in 30 minutes, prompting Zhou to hasten his journey to reach the nest. Upon arriving, Zhou entered the location, where he found a total of 5 large eggs. Zhao's hell mission entailed retrieving one of the eggs for the Beast King Union team. The weight of the egg amounted to several tons, which explained why no one else had been able to complete this mission. Fortunately, Zhou had his system storage, allowing him to easily place three eggs within his inventory. He left the remaining two eggs behind to prevent the dragon from attacking Titan City. When the dragon returned to its nest and discovered the absence of three eggs, it erupted into aggressive roars. The boss and Ao Wu, alerted by the commotion, ventured out to investigate. Ao Wu questioned why the dragon had become so agitated and furious. Suddenly, Zhou appeared behind them, seated on a large box, and informed them that the dragon had lost something. Reacting swiftly, the boss and Ao Wu launched an attack on Zhou, who managed to evade their strikes. In the process, their assault inadvertently destroyed the box, revealing a dragon egg inside. The egg's contents spilled onto their clothes. Zhou covered himself with a piece of the box to shield his attire from the egg's contents. At that moment, the dragon emerged before them. Upon witnessing its destroyed egg, the dragon entered a state of frenzy. The boss instructed Ao Wu to split up and escape, while the dragon demolished the building they were in. The dragon then turned its attention towards Ao Wu, delivering a devastating blow that sent him hurtling through multiple structures. Ao Wu sustained massive injuries, and the dragon finished him off with a powerful swipe of its claw. Meanwhile, the boss was attempting to flee, realizing that he needed water to wash away the smell. However, the dragon swiftly reappeared and struck the boss with a massive attack, crushing his bones. It proceeded to devour him, yet its bloodlust remained unsatiated, with the intention of attacking Titan City. Nonetheless, Zhou had foreseen this outcome and ignited fireworks near the two remaining eggs, causing the dragon to redirect its focus and protect them. Observing the dazzling display of fireworks, Zhou knew that it had likely been a long time since the people of Titan City had witnessed such a spectacle. Nearby, the Chuhi group was training, unaware of the unfolding events. At the stroke of midnight, the group was taken aback by the sudden burst of fireworks. They marveled at the vibrant display illuminating the night sky. Among them was Chu He, holding the esteemed rank of ninth-level martial artist. The following day, Chu He's group crossed paths with Zhou, but Zhou paid them no mind and continued on his way. One of Chu He's members remarked on their group's composure, unaffected by Zhao's presence. Despite being a mere sixth-level martial artist, Zhou dared to roam freely. Chu He expressed his intrigue, stating that he found Zhao to be highly interesting and that he would like to get to know him given the opportunity. Meanwhile, Zhou proceeded towards the Martial Artist Association to submit his hell mission. He pondered the size of the egg, contemplating the best approach to avoid revealing his system storage. With careful foresight, Zhou had made the necessary preparations beforehand. Upon arrival, Zhou encountered a group on their way to submit an Abyss Rank mission. They exuded an air of arrogance, considering their mission's difficulty. This group, known as the War Soul Squad, comprised martial artists of 8th-level rank. Ignoring the coup, they arrogantly approached the receptionist to submit their mission directly. In that moment, Zhou stepped forward, presenting his Purple Diamond member card to the receptionist. As soon as the receptionist laid eyes on the card, she promptly assured Zhou that she would assist him right away. The leader of the War Soul Squad, infuriated by Zhao's actions, accused him of flaunting a fake card in an attempt to show off. He warned Zhao to leave before he unleashed his wrath upon him. However, the receptionist clarified to Zhao that he was there solely to submit a hell mission. The revelation left everyone present astonished at Zhao's choice of mission. Director Shen sprinted towards the clan leader bureau, urgently delivering the news that Zhou Zheng had successfully completed the Beast King Union's hell mission. The clan leader was taken aback upon hearing this revelation. Meanwhile, at the Beast King Union office, the leader received word of the mission's completion and immediately set off to meet the person responsible. The Martial Artist Association's Sharp Squad stood guard, preventing anyone from approaching the association, as they protected the precious egg that Zhou had brought. Zhao and Director Shen engaged in a conversation, praising Zhao's remarkable achievement. Director Shen took the opportunity to inquire if Zhou had considered the previous invitation, to which Zhou humbly declined, expressing his intent to carefully contemplate it. Joining the Martial Artist Association meant working under someone else, which would limit his freedom. Zhou was determined to rely on his own abilities to reach the pinnacle and safeguard those around him. This hell mission would serve as the foundation for his ascent. The leader of the Beast King Union, Hansdang Dom, arrived at the association. A man working with the association informed Han Zhang that the mission's payment would be transferred to the martial artist's bank account who had completed the mission. Han Zhang inquired about his team, but the man clarified that the mission had been accomplished solely by Zhou Zheng, the association's one and only Purple Diamond member, who had already departed. Han Zhang was astonished to learn that a single person had managed to complete the mission. Pondering how Zhou had overcome the challenge of retrieving an egg weighing several tons from a 200-meter-high building, the association's representative stated that they did not concern themselves with the details. They solely focused on the results. Zhou returned home, annoyed with the Martial Artist Association for taking his vehicle as a mission asset and driving away. Upon his return, Zhou astonished Lanxi with his breakthrough to rank 6. Su Yun quickly embraced him, expressing concern for his prolonged absence. Zhou informed them that they needed to pack up as they were moving to a new house. He showed them the map, indicating that their new residence would be in the city's third area. Lanxi voiced his concern about the cost, but Zhou reassured them, revealing the orange crystal he had obtained from the Hell Mission as a means of financial security. As Zhao's phone rang, Zhang reprimanded him for hiding from his friends and accomplishing something significant alone. Zhou admitted his surprise at completing the mission himself, and Zhang insisted that they celebrate with a grand feast. Zhou decided to invite them to the Star Crown Hotel. He extended the invitation to Zhang, along with Ziyao and Wu Chao. At the hotel, the manager instructed the staff to hasten their preparations, emphasizing the arrival of an important guest. Manager Zhao approached Mr. Pang to request a room change, but an irate Mr. Pang questioned why he should comply. Zhao explained that Zhou Zheng, the guest of importance who had just completed a high-ranking mission, was coming. This presented a perfect opportunity for Mr. Pang to finally meet Zhou, as he had expressed a desire to do so in the past. Upon hearing this, Mr. Pang's attitude completely shifted, and he eagerly relinquished his room for Zhou. As Zhou arrived at the hotel, he couldn't help but feel bewildered by the overwhelming respect shown towards him, briefly questioning if he had entered the wrong place. Manager Zhao conveyed to Zhao that it was a great honor for him to host the banquet at their venue. Upon Zhao's arrival at the hotel, Zhang, accompanied by Xiao and Wu, expressed their congratulations and celebrated Zhao's success. Later that night, an unknown man remarked that even a loner, like a rogue, would still need friends, just as the moonlight could alleviate the coldness of the dark night. The man happened to stumble upon Zhao Zheng's files and found him intriguing. The man's servant informed his boss that he understood and would arrange a meeting with Zhou. The following morning, the city lord's helicopter flew towards Zhao's residence. After landing, a beautiful woman approached Zhou, informing him that the city lord wished to have breakfast together. Zhou accepted the invitation, and they returned to the city lord's residence, guided by the city lord's servant. As Zhou entered, he beheld a grand breakfast table. The city lord, named Mo Wu, welcomed Zhou and asked him to take a seat. Mo explained that he had initially wanted to invite Zhou for dinner the previous night, but refrained from disturbing him due to his celebratory gathering with friends. However, Mo congratulated Zhou on completing an unimaginable mission. He further mentioned his preference for enjoying food while savoring the outdoor scenery, encouraging Zhao to relax and make himself at home. After half an hour, Mo inquired if Zhao was full, to which Zhou playfully responded by gesturing towards the abundance of food on the table. He praised the city lord, noting that the luxurious breakfast was a testament to one's foolishness if they chose not to indulge in it. Mo then questioned Zhao if he was curious about why he had invited him for breakfast. As the maid brought tea for them, Mo continued to explain that he wanted to meet Zhao and discuss the true distribution of benefits in Titan City and the Martial Artist Association. He mentioned that the association respected Titan City and its benefits based on martial artist ranks. When Zhao became a one-star Purple Diamond member, he would be entitled to enjoy the dividends of the Titan City Martial Artist Association. Furthermore, as a five-star Purple Diamond member and the 27th-ranked martial artist in Titan City, Zhou would receive his portion from the top 25 martial artists. Mo stood up and turned on the projector, revealing a map of Titan City and its neighboring cities, he revealed a more exciting plan for Zhao to consider. The projector showcased the option for Zhao to obtain a 10% share of a new city and gain control over the operation rights of any street except 1-5. Zhou was surprised to learn that Titan City still had a new city available. Mo explained that although the new city was not yet reclaimed, they were planning to rebuild the Yanghe City, located 150 kilometers away, to serve as a resting place for martial artists going on hunts and missions. He assured Zhao that reclaiming the city wouldn't be a major issue once all the resources were gathered, and it would only take a few months of reconstruction. Zhou gazed at the map and expressed his admiration, deciding to assist with this operation. After careful consideration, Zhou informed Mo that he would take a 10% profit share of the new city and the operation rights of Street 6. Upon Zhao's departure, Mo's servant asked if the profit distribution was too much. Mo responded that it was not excessive because Zhao's potential was worth sacrificing such resources. He emphasized that Titan City, being just a small area in the apocalypse world, had to do everything possible to keep a talented martial artist like Zhou within its borders. News of the new city operation quickly spread among the people, bringing them joy as they no longer had to worry about sleeping in the wilderness while cultivating. The scene shifted to leader Wu and his companion Ku Hang. Wu asked Ku why he seemed upset when they were going to the new city. Ku responded by expressing his concern about Zhou Zheng being the co-leader of the pioneer team this time. Wu confirmed this fact, but reassured Ku that Zhou was not the type of person to be feared. Zhao then arrived at the Titan team area in his car and expressed his enthusiasm for working together with them for a period of time. Although some team members were unhappy with having a rank 6 martial artist as their guide, Zhou acknowledged their discontent and issued a challenge. He declared that if any of them could defeat him, he would gladly let that person take on the co-leader position. Ku initially desired to challenge Zhou, but leader Wu reminded him of Liu Guohai's fate. In the past, Zhou was merely a 3rd-ranked martial artist, yet he managed to defeat an 8th-ranked martial artist. Now Zhou has climbed to rank 6, indicating a significant increase in strength. Hearing this, Hu withdrew his challenge. However, Lai Fang Xing, an 8th-ranked martial artist known as Berserk 3, stepped forward and accepted the challenge. Zhou, curious, inquired if there were any other contenders. Lai Fang replied, advising Zhao to focus on their match first and consider challenging others later. Zhou, acknowledging Lai Fang's suggestion, obtained 2 branch sticks, stating that barehanded combat wouldn't reveal Lai Fang's true power. As the fight commenced, Lai Fang charged toward Zhao. Yet, just as Lai Fang neared to strike, Zhou vanished and reappeared behind him, signifying the end of the fight. The spectators were astounded by Zhou's incredible strength. They proceeded to their destination, a new city, along the way. The team marveled at Zhou's footwork and requested his guidance and protection. Zhou humbly expressed that he was accustomed to hunting alone and had never led or commanded a team before. Thus, he requested their magnanimity, emphasizing his need for their support. Upon arrival, they began strategizing their next steps. They divided into 2 teams. The leader of Team 2 issued a warning to his team, stating that those who failed to follow his instructions should not hold him responsible for the consequences. Similarly, Wu, the leader of Team 1, conveyed the same message to his team. While Wu scouted ahead, he alerted the group to the presence of a small band of poison zombies, urging them to pick up the pace. Zhou, the co-leader, confidently declared that he would handle the group of poison zombies alone. Wu questioned his ability to manage them single-handedly, but Zhou, exuding a powerful aura, assured his team not to worry and that he would dispatch the zombies swiftly. Zhou engaged in combat, utilizing his bow to slay the zombies one by one. Finally, he leaped into the air, releasing a flurry of arrows that eliminated multiple zombies simultaneously. Once again, the team marveled at Zhou's extraordinary capabilities. Wu informed Zhou to retreat as a high-level poison zombie was approaching his location. Suddenly, an alight zombie materialized before Zhou. Unfazed, Zhou commented that if it had come, they needed to eliminate it. He requested that the team support him from a distance. Wu directed the other members to provide long-range assistance to Zhou. Meanwhile, a member of Team 2 informed their leader about Team 1 facing an elite poison zombie. The leader sarcastically remarked that they were betting on when Team 1 would seek help from them. However, before they could act, Zhou had already slain the elite zombie. The speed and efficiency of his kill were astonishing. As a result, Zhou reached level 48. Night had descended upon them, and the team found shelter inside an abandoned structure. Wu reached out to Ao Zhu, the leader of Team 2, to relay the news that Team 1 had already eliminated the central area of the city. He inquired about the progress of Team 2. Ao Zhu responded, stating that they had made significant headway and had taken down 7 elite poison zombies. Wu advised him to rest well, as the main force team would arrive the next day to provide assistance and bring the mission to completion. Wu then gathered his own team and acknowledged the contribution of co-leader Zhou, whose efforts had greatly expedited their progress. Zhou humbly attributed the success to the hard work of everyone. One member of the team chimed in, expressing curiosity about Team 2's experience of falling behind. The following day, both teams continued their efforts to clear the area. Zhou, with his unwavering determination, swiftly dispatched the zombies. Realizing that the task was too time-consuming to handle individually, Zhou asked his team about the whereabouts of the grenades they had brought along. Wu pointed to a box nearby, indicating that all the grenades were stored there. Meanwhile, Ao Zhu and his team were also engaged in eliminating the zombies in their vicinity. One of his team members informed him of Zhou's unconventional approach of using grenades to bomb the poison zombies. Zhou fearlessly moved amidst the chaos, hurling grenades and neutralizing the threats. Ao Zhu considered Zhou's actions reckless, as the noise from the explosions would attract more zombies. At that moment, the main force team arrived, guided by the clan leader Bureau. They immediately launched a fierce assault, swiftly eliminating all the zombies in the city. After 3 days of relentless efforts, the area was finally reclaimed. Zhou informed his team that he would return to the city first and instructed them to contact him if any situation arose. The team jokingly remarked that Zhou was rushing back due to missing his wife. Zhou played along, teasingly warning them that they would face his retribution upon his return. Zhou set off. Along the way, he expressed his anticipation for the establishment of a conducive resting place, which would serve as a solid base of operations. As he traveled, he encountered a transport vehicle besieged by multiple monstrous creatures. The martial artist within the vehicle had sent out a distress signal, but had to wait for 30 minutes until the Titan Guard team arrived. Observing the situation, Zhou asked if they needed assistance. One of the martial artists was astonished, questioning Zhao's sanity for venturing alone into such a dangerous scenario, given that he was only a rank 6 martial artist. Ignoring the concerns, Zhou nonchalantly exited his car, remarking that it seemed they truly needed his help. Zhou confronted the horde of monsters single-handedly, employing his skill Boomerang Catapult to dispatch them all. As the remaining monster lunged at him, Zhou evaded the attack and swiftly dealt the finishing blow. The martial artist stood in awe, witnessing a rank 6 martial artist effortlessly vanquishing their foes. Uncle Wang contacted Zhou, informing him that the special healing medicine had been successfully created. Zhou retraced his steps back to the research lab in the mansion, where Uncle Wang informed him that the potion was now complete. Upon seeing it, Zhou remarked that it was identical to the potion in the game. Uncle Wang added that the effects of the Jin Chuan medicine were not noteworthy and lamented the scarcity of blood orchids, resulting in limited production of this type of medicine. He explained that the blood orchids Zhou had provided could only produce around 300 bottles. Curious, Zhou opened the potion and tasted it, confirming that it was indeed the same as the HP potion in the game. He marveled at the fact that the real world could replicate the potion. Curious about the number of bottles produced, Zhou inquired how many were made. Uncle Wang replied that there were 87 bottles. He also mentioned that the remaining ingredients could be used to create an ointment, which was weaker than the potions but superior to Jin Chuan medicine. Excited about the success of the medicine, Zhou decided to acquire all the potions and instructed Uncle Wang to keep the remaining ointment. He anticipated a significant increase in the price of the treatment medicine in the near future. Satisfied with the medicine's success, Zhou began planning his next move. He realized that once the number one area was developed, numerous martial artists would flock there, presenting a lucrative business opportunity. He immediately called Xiao and proposed the opportunity to him. Later, at the Xiao Hang team's base, Xiao gathered his team and opened a box filled with green crystals. The team rejoiced, believing they had struck it rich. However, Xiao clarified that the crystals were not his but were provided by Zhou. He instructed his team to use the crystals exclusively for ointments and medicine. Meanwhile, Zhou ventured into the forest to hunt monsters. Unbeknownst to him, a group led by a martial artist was nearby. One of the members observed Zhou and informed their leader, referring to Zhou as an idiot practicing archery. Perplexed, the leader questioned why they should be surprised by someone practicing archery. The member urged the leader to take a look at Zhou's bow. After examining Zhou's bow, the leader decided to approach Zhou. It appeared that this group was affiliated with Chu Tianhe, the father of the young master who had hired other group leaders to search for his son. As witnessed before, Zhou had eliminated the entire group, including the young master. Zhou had reached level 49 and was on the brink of leveling up to 50, which would grant him a new skill. The leader and his group arrived at Zhou's location, ordering him to come down as their leader wanted to have a chat with him. Unfazed, Zhou disregarded their presence and continued his hunting. Suddenly, one of the group members lunged at Zhou, launching an attack. Swiftly, Zhou leaped into the air and eliminated the monster in front of him. He deftly evaded the next attack from his assailant and successfully dodged yet another strike. By slaying that monster, Zhou reached level 50, unlocking a new skill called Stun. This skill allowed him to incapacitate a target, causing them to enter a faint state that lasted for 2 minutes. Without hesitation, Zhou employed the Stun skill on the attacker and swiftly followed up with backstabs to finish him off. The group and their leader were astonished by Zhou's formidable strength. Zhou, with a wicked smile, questioned why they were scared when they had called him out. The leader revealed their affiliation with the Tianhe gang and warned Zhou to consider the consequences of crossing paths with them. Upon hearing the mention of the Tianhe gang, Zhao's smile grew even more sinister as he expressed mock sadness over his inability to find worthy opponents to test his skills on. The leader of the group made an announcement, promising a reward of a low-grade purple crystal to whoever managed to kill Zhou. Two members of the group charged at Zhou, but he swiftly infused his daggers with poison using his skill. Employing his flash skill, Zhou instantly disappeared and reappeared behind them, slashing one of them down. He then utilized his boomerang catapult skill to eliminate the remaining enemies. The leader, undeterred, launched an attack at Zhou, but Zhou effortlessly dodged it. He employed his stun skill to stun the leader, holding his dagger against his neck, and taunted him about the Tianhe gang's knack for provoking him. Zhou swiftly sliced the leader's neck, ending his life. While looting the fallen enemies, a rank 8 steel-armored cow suddenly appeared and launched an attack on Zhou. The cow positioned itself and charged at Zhou once again. Zhou leaped over the cow, using stun to disrupt its balance. He swiftly moved to its back and unleashed multiple backstabs, but the cow's high resilience made it difficult to inflict significant damage. Realizing that he could only defeat it slowly, Zhou endured as the cow attempted to dislodge him by jumping and throwing him off its back. Zhou maintained his hold on the cow, relentlessly attacking with his dagger. After 6 hours of intense running and jumping, Zhou finally managed to defeat the cow. Prepared to deliver the final blow, Zhou noticed a sorrowful expression on the cow's face. Moved by its pitiful gaze, Zhou decided against killing it as it pleaded for mercy. That night, Zhou set up a small campfire and spent the night there. The following morning, Zhou heard a sound indicating the cow's recovery. To his surprise, the cow appeared before him and immediately dashed towards him. Expecting another attack, Zhou readied his dagger, but instead, the cow licked his hands, expressing gratitude. The scene shifts to a group of martial artists traveling on the road. Ho Zi points out that they have encountered someone riding a rank 7 land travel bird. His friend advises him not to speak recklessly, even if it's just a rank 7 land travel bird. He mentions that even the Beast King Union has only a few birds, each costing more than a purple crystal. Ho Zi suggests that when they become rich, they should buy some too. His friend responds that it's not just about money, but also about having the right identity. He warns Zhou Zheng that if he continues to act arrogantly, he will face significant losses. Suddenly, Zhou appears in front of them, riding his rank 8 steel armored cow. He greets them, and they greet him back. Zhou continues on his way. Zhou Zheng asks his friend if he knows who Zhou is, to which his friend replies that he doesn't. Confused, Zhou Zheng mentions that his friend also greeted Zhou. His friend explains that Zhou's steel-armored cow is a rare rank 8 creature, and he might be the only one in Titan City who has it. Zhou reaches the entrance of the city and realizes he cannot put his pet into a bag. Additionally, wild monsters are not allowed to enter the city. Leaving his pet outside might put it at risk of being killed by other martial artists. The pet system will not unlock until he reaches level 60. He remembers Zhang Shihan and decides to find her. Meanwhile, Shihan is with her friend Qin Yun, showing her a beautiful place. Qin Yun asks why Shihan didn't tell her about it earlier. Shihan explains that she recently discovered it, and since they were passing by, she wanted to show it to Qin Yun. A group of martial artists arrives, riding various beasts. Their leader is the young Master Min, riding a land travel bird. It becomes clear that the group Zhou greeted earlier was referring to the young Master Min and his land travel bird. Min greets Miss Qin Yun, complimenting her on her beauty. Then his attention turns to Shihan, thinking to himself that she seems special. Shihan tells Qin Yun that she will go and rest there first. Min, not wanting Shihan to leave, intervenes and introduces himself to her as Min Wen, the CEO of the Minxi organization. Shihan remains indifferent, stating that they can chat and she won't disturb them. Min insists that she stays, offering her a ride on his land travel bird. He is planning to get closer to Shihan, believing she is different from other girls he has met. Shihan privately comments that this type of dandy guy is the most annoying, even the union leader needs to give his father some face. She wonders how she can reject his offer. Suddenly, Zhou appears, calling out to Shihan. Everyone is impressed to see Zhou riding a steel-armored cow. Zhou asks Shihan if she has time for him. Shihan apologizes to Min Wen, mentioning that her friend is waiting for her. She then rides the cow with Zhou, and they continue on their way. Min is deeply upset that Zhou has taken Shihan away from him. Min immediately rushes towards his bird, but one of his followers warns him not to chase after Zhou, stating that the person is Zhou Wen. Upon hearing Zhao's name, Min is shocked to realize that the seemingly ordinary person is the legendary figure who has caused a stir in Titan City. He thinks to himself that he's lucky he never provoked Zhou, otherwise his father would have forced him to apologize. He returns to Qin Yun and asks if she wants to ride his mount and travel with him. Meanwhile, Zhou and Shihan are on their way, and Shihan asks where he got the cow from. Zhou tells her that he fought it, and the cow almost got killed, but then it followed him. He explains that he came looking for her to see if there's a better pet-raising experience. Shihan responds that taming a pet requires multiple steps and different methods according to the pet's habits. It's not as simple as Zhou said. She continues to say that if he encounters any problems while feeding the pet, he can come and ask her. In a romantic moment, Shihan's face starts to blush as she speaks. She informs Zhou that she has other things to do and they will meet again next time. Zhou asked her if she can give him her contact number or how he can find her. The view then switches to a group of martial artists trying to buy medicine, but are unable to due to the increased prices set by the merchants. The merchants are now known as evil merchants. Zhou contacts Zhou and informs him that they managed to stock up on enough medicine in time, but the evil merchants are trying to get people killed. Zhou explains that the number one area will be open soon, so the evil merchants are doing this to increase sales there. Zhou tells Zhou that they were just a step ahead and instructs him not to sell yet, but to save a few crystals just in case. Zhou contacts Zhang, who is at the Titan City construction site. Zhang informs Zhou that they have hired the best garden designer to create a whole design for the street, including leisure services. Zhou asks about the budget, and Zhang confirms that it is high, but assures him that once the street is constructed, it will be a top-notch scenery in Titan City. Zhou comments on how quickly the crystals are being spent and decides that he needs to sell some things to get his money back. Zhou accessed his inventory and mused. It's been such a long time. The Sky River group must have given up on searching. After eliminating their group, Zhou looted their garments and weapons. Although they were in poor condition, they weren't beyond salvage. Setting up a stall on the street, Zhou contemplated, "It's been ages since I last did this. Perhaps it will be busier now." He wondered if he could find a trustworthy individual to assist him in selling these worn-out pieces of equipment and weapons. Suddenly, an elderly man accompanied by his entourage approached Zhou. The old man requested to inspect the quality of the items. As he glanced at the clothes, he immediately recognized them as belonging to the Sky River Group. However, he chose to conceal his knowledge and continue behaving normally. The old man casually remarked, "These heavily damaged pieces of equipment require no repairs. No one would buy them." Curious about his options, Zhou inquired about what he should do. In response, the old man informed Zhou about a repair store capable of marginally restoring the equipment. He mentioned that he would offer a fair price for the products. Sensing that the old man was merely putting on an act, Zhou asked him about the value of a single set. Unbeknownst to the old man, Zhou had already discerned his deceptive behavior. The old man proposed trading one white high-rank crystal for a set and expressed his desire to purchase all of them. Suddenly, a young man appeared and approached Zhou, stating that his equipment was not bad and worth at least a high-rank blue crystal. He mentioned that Tao Chao Nan, the old man's name, was someone whom nobody dared to provoke. However, the young man boldly declared, "But I am not afraid. Such exceptional equipment, yet Tao Chao only offered a high-rank white crystal price." He then turned to Tao Chao's group, accusing them of attempting to deceive unsuspecting individuals. Tao Chao admonished the young man, urging him not to falsely accuse others. Already harboring disdain for the young man, Tao Chao's anger flared up, and he ordered his group to drag the young man to the outskirts of the city to be devoured by wolves. However, as the young man sprinted away, Zhou intervened and apprehended him. The young man cried out, pleading to be released. His screams were intended to attract the attention of the Titan team, who would capture Zhou for his alleged crimes. This had been a prearranged plan between the young man and Tao Chao. However, Zhou had already discerned their scheme earlier. The young man's name was Dan Yang Lin. Zhou approached him and inquired if he would be interested in assisting with the sale of the equipment. Tao Chao then instructed Zhou to mind his own business. In response, Zhou swiftly drew a sword and positioned himself behind Tao Chao, threatening his life unless he left immediately. Tao Chao challenged Zhou, asking if he dared to kill someone in broad daylight. Just as the Titan guards arrived at the scene, Tao Chao continued his arrogant remarks, convinced that the guards would apprehend Zhou. However, to his surprise, the guards captured Tao Chao instead. One of the guards apologized to Zhou, while the other mercilessly struck Tao Chao. Zhou informed the guard that their offense was not significant, as they merely found a location and detained Tao Chao for a few days. Afterward, Zhou accompanied Yang Lin to an open-air noodle store. Zhou inquired why Yang Lin wasn't eating, questioning whether the noodles at that establishment were unsatisfactory. Yang Lin responded that it wasn't the case, as the noodle store was renowned for its excellent quality. Zhou then stated that, as someone who had experienced certain things, Yang Lin should already be aware that the source of these old equipment was the Sky River Group. He asked Yang Lin for assistance. Yang Lin inquired why Zhou had chosen him, to which Zhou replied, "Because of your character." Later, Zhou went to inspect his cattle and encountered Ao Zhu, who commended him, saying, "You're amazing. You managed to obtain a rank 8 mount." Zhou attributed it to luck, and Ao Zhu jokingly suggested that he capture a rank 11 mutated lizard to use as his mount. Zhou retorted, "You really have a death wish." Then, Ao Zhu handed him a mission scroll and mentioned that the number one area had not yet been fully developed, but it was open to martial artists. In a hushed tone, Ao Zhu informed Zhou that he only needed to focus on settling down as a martial artist. Zhou expressed his gratitude to Ao Zhu. Afterward, Zhou strolled along the street and contacted Xiao to inquire about the condition of the medicine market. Xiao informed him that the prices had skyrocketed to 4 times their original value. Excited by this news, Zhou instructed Xiao to meet up with Zhang Xiao's transport team the following day and transport 60% of the medicine to their location. He added that if people from the Martial Artist Association came to purchase, They could sell it as long as the price wasn't lower than 4 white crystals. Xiao suggested waiting a bit longer, speculating that the price might rise to 5 white crystals. On the street, there was a man carrying a bag that hinted at increased weapon conductivity. He overheard Zhou and Qiao's conversation and remarked, "You hope others will think the same, but when there are numerous competitors, the price will drop." Intrigued, Zhou inquired about how to enhance weapon conductivity from the man. The system revealed the man's name as Gu Zhenyi, an apprentice mosaic master. Zhenyi explained to Zhou that he could enhance conductivity for a weapon by charging 1 high-rank green crystal. The level of conductivity would depend on the rank of the crystal provided. White crystal, 1% to 3%. Blue crystal, 3% to 6%. Green crystal, 6% to 9%. Purple crystal, 9% to 12%. The remaining enhancement percentage relied on Zhao's luck. However, Zhenyi cautioned Zhao that increasing conductivity was challenging and carried a certain risk. If the process failed, the weapon would be destroyed, and the crystal used would be lost as well. Additionally, the fee had to be paid in advance. Suddenly, a man appeared, accusing Zhenyi of being a liar and attempting to scam people. He warned Zhao not to trust Zhenyi, as the previous day, he had given him his weapon with 20% conductivity, only to be told today that it had been destroyed. The man was furious and declared that if he could fight, he would have killed Zhenyi. He vowed to guard the place and prevent Zhenyi from scamming anyone further. Upon hearing this, Zhou departed, while the man remained true to his word, vigilantly watching over the area to ensure Zhenyi didn't deceive anyone. As the sun began to set, Zhenyi packed his bag, preparing to leave. The man informed him that he would continue coming there. To Zhenyi's surprise, Zhou awaited him from the shadows. Zhenyi cautiously asked what Zhou wanted. Zhou reassured him, saying he simply wanted to do business. Zhenyi posed another question, asking if Zhou trusted him. Zhou replied, "If I didn't, why would I come?" Zhou had returned because the information provided by the system was reliable. This person undoubtedly possessed knowledge of mosaics. Zhou and Zhenyi decided to spend the night in one of the buildings nearby. Zhou entrusted his peerless dagger to Zhenyi, who remarked that only an expert could possess such a weapon. Zhou brushed off inquiries about his identity and asked how Zhenyi discovered the connection between mosaics and increased conductivity. Zhenyi explained that it was a fortunate occurrence, an unexpected chance discovery. He informed Zhou that the mosaic process would take at least a night, advising him to remain vigilant while he worked. As a show of trust, Zhenyi promised to accept the fee only if he succeeded. While Zhenyi left the room, Zhou contemplated the risks of revealing such a unique skill to others. Throughout the night, Zhou pondered the limited conductivity increase of the other weapon, feeling it was not worthwhile. He decided to take the risk with his peerless dagger, hoping for a successful enhancement. Otherwise, he would be left with a dagger with only 25% conductivity. As Zhou meditated and channeled his star power, Zhenyi returned to the room with a sorrowful expression. Fear gripped Zhou, thinking that he had lost his precious peerless dagger. However, Zhenyi clarified that he had only stepped out to drink water. As morning dawned, it was then that Zhou noticed the shattered peerless dagger. Zhenyi apologized, explaining that the chances of success were slim. Zhou woke up from his nightmare, realizing it was only a dream. Zhenyi stood before him, asking if he had another nightmare about the shattered dagger. Zhou was taken aback, accusing Zhenyi of trying to scare him to death. It seemed that Zhao's worries had unsettled his mind. Zhenyi urged him to see for himself, presenting the dagger. Zhou was stunned by the newly created Titan City's number 1 conductivity weapon. Zhenyi informed him that the dagger had increased by 12%. Its base conductivity was 35%, and with the enhancement, it now reached a total of 47% conductivity. Zhou acknowledged that Zhenyi's skills were exceptional, praising his discerning eyes. He contacted Chang, informing him that he possessed the Titan City's weapon world. Perplexed, Chang asked for clarification, prompting Zhao to invite him to Area 1, where he would reveal the details. In the number 1 area at Hanhai Medicine Store, martial artists flocked to buy various medicines. Xiao, responsible for the store, marveled at how the once inexpensive medicine was now worth 4 white crystals. He attributed this success to Zhao's foresight. The scene shifted to Chu Tianhe, leader of the Chu Tian gang, who was infuriated that his son had not returned from the forest. His servant arrived, presenting a kidnapped individual who might have information about the young master's disappearance. The one they kidnapped turned out to be Yang Lin, who had been selling the Sky River Group equipment Zhou had given him. Chu Tian confronted Yang Lin, demanding to know the whereabouts of his son. However, Yang Lin professed ignorance. In a fit of anger, Chu Tian hurled him off the edge of the roof. Chu Tian explained that the Sky River Group marked all their equipment, allowing for easy identification. His servant informed him that Kong Shen and others might already be dead, as the scratch on Kong Shen's equipment indicated a fight with a rank 6 Kang Wolf. Considering Kong Shen's combat ability, it suggested foul play. Chu Tian grew even more furious when his servant revealed that the equipment being sold had been requested by Zhou Zheng. Meanwhile, in the number one area, Chang arrived and called out for Zhou. Zhou remarked on how much the place had changed in such a short time. Chang attributed it to everyone's hard work. He reminded Zhou of their previous conversation, and Zhou presented his peerless dagger, showcasing its conductivity of over 40%. Chang was astounded and expressed his desire to meet the person responsible for the enhancement, regardless of the cost. Zhou agreed to facilitate their meeting, leaving the rest up to Chang. In the evening, Zhou arranged a meeting between Chang and Zhen Yi. The meeting appeared to go well, and Chang informed Zhou that they would return to Titan City. Zhou asked if Chang wouldn't stay until nightfall, but Chang explained that time is money and they needed to shock Titan City. As Chang and Zhen Yi departed, Zhao's phone began to ring. An unknown number was calling him. When Zhao answered, the caller revealed that the Sky River Group had kidnapped his family members just an hour ago, locking them in Outer City Area 7 of Sky River's branch. Only 3 members of the Warhammer team were still alive. Zhao questioned the caller's identity, but they simply replied that he didn't need to know and should have expected the consequences of provoking the Sky River Group. If Zhou arrived late, you would only find their corpses. Zhou attempted to contact the Warhammer team, but received no response, confirming that something serious had indeed occurred. As night fell, Zhou made his way to the Sky River Group's location. In the Outer City Area 7 of the Sky River's branch, Xiao, the leader of the Warhammer team, and his follower were imprisoned in a white room. Lan Xi and Su Yun soon entered the room. One of the guards instructed the other 2 guards to blow the whistle immediately if there was any trouble. Outside the branch, Zhou remained in a stealthy state, observing the area. He successfully infiltrated the branch and overheard the guards discussing the location of the kidnapped individuals on the 11th floor of the fire mist. Zhao took the elevator to the 11th floor. Taking advantage of a guard who left to use the toilet, Zhao swiftly eliminated the remaining guard by slicing his neck. Although he searched the guard's body, Zhao couldn't find the keys. When the other guard returned, Zhou ambushed and killed him as well. He then opened the room where his friends were held captive. Zhou carried Su Yun, and they started making their way out of the branch to escape. Zhou asked Su Yun if she was scared, to which she responded that she wasn't because she knew Zhou would come to their rescue. As the other guards discovered the dead guard at the room's door, they realized that Zhou and the others hadn't fled far and initiated a chase. Zhou and his group reached the city's exit, where the guards informed them that leaving the city was restricted before daylight. Upon recognizing Zhou, the guards immediately opened the door. Xiao was furious about losing his team and vowed to seek revenge. Zhou assured him that he wouldn't let their comrades' deaths be in vain and instructed Xiao to return to Area 1 to prepare. They would deal with the Sky River Group together. The guards of the Sky River Group reached the exit and ordered the Titan Guard team to open the gate. However, the Titan Guard refused to comply. The next morning, Zhou and Xiao planned their next move. Zhou marked on the map that the Sky River Group consisted of over 1,000 people. While they couldn't eliminate them all at once, they could slowly strike and eliminate them one by one. The scene then shifted to the cars of the Sky River Group on the road. Zhou appeared in front of them, riding his steel-armored cow. As he charged forward, he crushed their cars, taking them by surprise. For the past few days, Zhou had been relentlessly harassing the Sky River Group's cultivation teams, resulting in many deaths and severe injuries among their members. Chu Tian ordered his servant to issue new orders for each team, requiring a high-ranking martial artist to accompany them on their outings. Meanwhile, Zhou and Jiao waited for a Sky River Group to pass by so they could initiate an ambush. Zhou remarked that their harassment seemed to be effective and informed Jiao that they needed to retreat. Curious, Jiao asked why they should leave. Zhou explained that the Sky River Group must have realized their tactics and would now send high-ranking martial artists, negating their advantage. Just then, Chu Timan contacted Zhou, threatening to kill him. Zhou retorted that he was already tired and suggested they discuss more realistic matters. Zhou proposed a meeting in 3 days in Area 1, where Chu Tian should come alone and bring 10 advanced rank purple crystals as an exchange for his son's release. Xiao questioned Zhao's claim about his son, stating that Chu Xiang, his son, had died long ago. Zhou clarified that he fabricated that information to lure Chu Tian out. He also revealed his intention to destroy the entire Sky River Group, although not everyone agreed with his plan. The scene shifted to Lord Mo, the ruler of Titan City. Mo didn't care about Chu Tian personally, but didn't want the Sky River Group to be destroyed. Mo's concern lay in the group's existence rather than its leadership. Mo's servants expressed their worries about Zhou, but Mo dismissed it as normal temperament. He explained that he allowed the Sky River Group to expand previously to create a triangular power balance with the Red Tripod Company. However, after Chu Tian lost his son, the Sky River Group became impulsive. Since Chu Tian could no longer bring benefits to Titan City, Mo struck a deal with Zhao to allow him to kill Chu Tian, but spare the Sky River Group. After 3 days, true to Zhao's instructions, Chu Tian arrived in Area 1, shouting for Zhou Zheng to show himself. Zhou observed him from a distance and then took out a rocket launcher from his inventory. He fired it at nearby buildings to bait Chu Tian. Chu Tian gave chase until they reached the middle of the forest. Impatient, Chu Tian demanded to know where his son was. Zhou urged him to wait and witness some magic first. Zhao took out a water crystal fruit from his inventory and claimed it was a rare mutated plant that emitted star power, attracting high-ranking mutated beasts. Chu Tian grew frustrated, accusing Zhao of playing tricks and demanding his son's return. Zhao taunted him, stating that despite his talent, his son had become a burden and dragged him down. Chu Tian asked for clarification, and Zhou mockingly revealed that most of the Sky River Group no longer supported Chu Tian and even the city lord had abandoned him. Infuriated, Chu Tian refused to believe Zhao's words. Zhao then presented a piece of his son's life-saving armor, claiming it was the only thing left on his body. Enraged, Chu Tian lunged at Zhao. Zhou quickly tossed the water crystal fruit into the air, summoning a giant white tiger. Zhou informed Chu Tian that the area behind him was filled with high-ranking mutated beasts. With a farewell message, Zhao disappeared, leaving Chu Tian to face not only the white tiger, but also a giant lizard that emerged to attack. It appeared to be the end for Chu Tian. The news of Chu Tian's disappearance spread rapidly, as it had been half a month since anyone had seen him. Zhou arrived at the martial artist training center, where the receptionist welcomed him. Immediately, Zhou requested a rank 8 room, indicating that he was close to reaching rank 7. This meant that his rogue level could increase to level 60. After half an hour, Zhou emerged from the room victorious. He returned home to the warm greetings of Lan Sai and Su Yun. Lan Sai was thrilled that Zhou had become a rank 7 martial artist. Zhou encouraged Lan Sai to continue working hard, and he informed them that he would be leaving for a while. During Zhao's absence, Lan Xi would stay with Xiao Hang for training, and Zhou entrusted the house to Lan Xi. Lan Xi reassured Zhao not to worry. Su Yun cautioned Zhao to be extremely careful, and he affectionately patted her head, assuring her that he would be fine. With that, Zhou embarked on his next mission with the beast Yunin King and Ao Zhu. Along the way, Ao Zhu questioned Zhao about his lack of concern for Su Yun's feelings. Zhao explained that Su Yun was not someone who would get upset easily, and this was a rare opportunity to work with the beast Yunin King that he didn't want to miss. Shi Han grew upset with Zhao's response, criticizing his cautiousness and suggesting that he could have gone home and accompanied Su Yun instead. Ao Zhu then revealed that the Han Jiang Dong clan leader and others were planning to repair the path from Titan City to the burial area. They believed that with Zhao's help, their chances of success would be higher. Lost in his thoughts, Zhu recalled his conversation with the Beast Union King about the mission. The leader emphasized the need to open the path between Titan City and the burial area smoothly, as it would lead to profitable business cooperation. Zhou acknowledged the potential profit and agreed to work with the Beast Union King on equal terms, receiving 10% of the profit. Amidst his contemplation, Shai Han called Zhao multiple times, trying to capture his attention. She inquired about his iron armor cowl, and Zhu assured her that he had kept it in a safe place. However, unbeknownst to her, Zhu had actually stored it inside the pet list, which he had unlocked after reaching level 60. Shi Han expressed relief that Zhu hadn't brought the cowl along, as the mission was crucial, and any mishap involving the beasts would be detrimental. As they arrived at the entrance of the red area, they abandoned their cars and continued on foot due to the dangerous nature of the place. While venturing deeper into the area, they encountered a troublesome situation ahead. A poison zombie was engaged in a battle with a group of crow armor rats. Ao Zhu remarked that it was problematic since crow armor rats typically lived in groups, and the presence of the poison zombie could attract more of them. As the poison zombie attacked the rats, more and more rats emerged, intensifying the situation. The leader of the Beast Union King quickly instructed the team to move to the upper floor. As soon as the rats sensed their presence, they launched an immediate attack. Shi Han was attacked by a rat and became frightened. Zhao swiftly leaped to her rescue and advised her to be more careful, emphasizing that he couldn't always be there to help her. They managed to reach the upper floor, where the leader instructed them to jump to the opposite floor. Everyone successfully made the jump, except for Shi Han, who couldn't reach the distant opposing floor. Without hesitation, Zhu assured Shi Han that he would assist her. He used his hands as support to propel her across to the other floor. As the rats approached, Zhu urged the rest of the team to leave and promised to contact them later. The leader and Han Xiu called out to him, urging him to join them, but Zhu directed their attention to the area below. He remarked that without someone luring the rats away, no one could escape. Below them, a group of cow armor rats had gathered. As the rats reached the top, Zhou initiated a daring escape. He started running, drawing the attention of all the rats towards him. With agility and precision, Zhou leaped over rooftops, utilizing a hook from his inventory to navigate through the buildings. Shi Han expressed concern for Zhao's safety, prompting the leader to reassure her that with his skills, Zhao should be fine. The leader was taken aback by Shi Han's worry for Zhou, referring to her as their union's flower. Shi Han explained that she felt responsible for causing him to fall behind, and that was why she worried about him. The leader imparted the wisdom that caring for others is not a negative trait and emphasized the need to swiftly progress and not waste the opportunities Zhu had created. Meanwhile, as Zhu continued his acrobatic rooftop maneuvers, he also strategically threw grenades at the pursuing rats, diminishing their numbers. When he reached a suitable location, he came to a halt and summoned his trusty steel-armored cow. Zhou mounted the cow and charged at the rat, delivering a powerful impact that sent the rat flying. Witnessing this, the other rats immediately scattered and fled. The team eagerly awaited Zhou's return, with Shi Han expressing her worries. Ao Zhu reassured her, stating that Zhu would be fine since he never engages in activities he lacks confidence in. Soon, Zhu rejoined the group, and they were relieved to see him unharmed. The leader expressed gratitude to Zhao and informed everyone that the center of the red area was just ahead, emphasizing the need for extreme caution. At that moment, one of the union leader's followers returned with news that they had discovered a tanker at a nearby petrol station. The team decided to utilize the tanker as a means of transportation, allowing them to make their way to the burial area. They rode on the back of the tanker, with Zhou using a sniper gun to eliminate any monsters that approached them. Ao Zhu praised Zhao's sniping skills, but Zhu modestly stated that he was merely playing around. As night fell, they sought shelter in one of the buildings. The union leader and Zhang Huo volunteered to guard the night, urging the rest to rest and prepare for the next day. From the balcony of the building, Zhou and Shi Han watched fireworks illuminating the sky. Shi Han admired their beauty and asked Zhou about their nature. Zhou explained that they were a type of seed that, when heated, shot up into the sky and dispersed, benefiting from the cool night to protect the seeds from sunlight radiation. Shi Han expressed her gratitude to Zhou for the knowledge he shared. Zhou playfully reminded her that she had already thanked him before and questioned whether she would help him if he were in danger. She responded with a maybe and went to sleep. The following morning, the team encountered another group of martial artists engaged in a deadly conflict. The group's leader ordered his team to check for any survivors and eliminate them if found. Upon inspection, they discovered that all members of the opposing group had been brutally murdered. As the tanker carrying Zhao and the others passed by, one of the group members reported to their leader that the tanker had witnessed their violent act. They debated whether to pursue the tanker, and the leader instructed his subordinate to inform their comrades in the city to keep a watchful eye on the tanker.